Hello 11 TS community, it's Jules. Today I'm beautiful and sunny Munich with Glódis Viggósdóttir. She played for Bayern Munich and the Icelandic national team, and we're gonna talk about her road to Wembley. Enjoy!
Excuse me, June, understand where I'm at. I was all around the world, on span, across the map. I've been laying low and now it's time to pop up, bitch, I'm back. Now I'm gonna run it up. Snooze on the kid that you dumb or what? You better go get your numbers up.
Hey Glódis, nice to meet you here in the sunny Munich.
Yes, very nice day.
It's your first year in Germany, in the German Bundesliga. How are you doing?
It's been a good year. It's been really cool to be here. I think it's a good league. Disappointed that we didn't win, but next year.
And let's talk about your grassroots. So can you tell us where and when did your journey start?
So I started playing football in Denmark, actually, when I was 8 years old. Then I moved on, or my family moved back to Iceland when I was 10. So I kept going from there, and then I played in Iceland until I was 16, and then I moved up to the highest league in Iceland. And then when I had won the league and the cup in 2014, I wanted to get a new challenge and do something else, so I moved to Sweden. And then when I had done the same there, I thought I need a new challenge, so here I am in Germany.
Nice. Was it always your dream to become a professional football player?
I wouldn't say always, because I didn't really know that it was a possibility for many years, but when I knew that it was an option, I think that's when you were like, oh, that could be really cool. And you started to see more female players that had the opportunity to go and play abroad and be pros. So I think from maybe when I was like 14, I started to see more role models in those positions. And that's when you're like, this could be a possibility. So that's when you start to dream.
Do you think this will involve or more evolve in the future?
Yes, I think so, definitely, because you can see that women's football is growing more and there's more role models visible to young girls, so maybe they can start to dream now when they're 6, 7, 8, and I think that's a really nice thing, because that wasn't a possibility when I was that age, because then it was only...
So you didn't have an idol or role model or something?
Not in football, no, but I had a... Later on, a role model, she was the captain of our national team, and she was playing abroad in Sweden. So she became kind of what I wanted to be. I wanted to go abroad and play and be like her. And then I got to play with her in the national team later on, so that was really cool.
What do you think about when you see a young generation wearing your jersey with your name? What does it make you feel?
It's always like, it's nice. Like, you feel proud and you feel happy that you are able to be that role model that maybe I didn't have when I was younger in football, and I just think it's really nice when you see your name on the back of a kid playing. It's big.
What did you learn from your study psychology for football?
I don't know if it was anything specific, like from psychology, but just more maybe like small tricks of when things aren't going well or when you make a mistake, like how to trick your mind into getting back on track and not letting it affect you.
So what inspired you to study?
I think it was mostly just, it's sad, but it's the fact that when I started going abroad to play, that you don't think that you're going to earn enough money so that when you are done that you can live off it. So that's just the way it is in women's football, or was back then. So I just wanted to have a degree so that when I was finished with football, I had something ready that I could step into when I was finished.
So did you ever felt inequality in your journey?
Yeah, I think every woman footballer has felt it, and it can be anything from small things like when I was really young, like with the training times and the fields and everything, you could just feel that we were not the priority or not equal to the boys. And I think that carried on from when I was, I don't know when it starts, when you're maybe 10, 11, that's when the boys start to get the better training times and all this stuff. And it carries on till when I was in the first team in my team in Iceland. Then we had to train at 9 in the evening because the boys had to train first.
How important is mental health for you or for team sports in general?
I think it's really important that people are in an environment, especially football players, where they feel that they can talk about how they feel and be authentically themselves, and where it's accepted that you're not going to be 100% happy or glad all the time, and that's normal, and so you can get help if you have anxiety, or no matter what it is.
What do you do for your mental health?
I don't know if I do anything specific, but for me it's important that you're not thinking about football 24/7, that you can sometimes like go home and think about something else, so that when you're there you can be 100% focused on what you're doing, and you try. It's hard because it always, yeah, it's always in the back of your mind, but after a game, if it doesn't go well, that you try and not think about it constantly, because that can be really hard.
What was, in your opinion, the best development in the last couple of years in women's football?
I think the visibility of women's football is the biggest thing that's kind of pushed the women's football even more, because if it's always there and it's always in people's faces, they know when games are happening, they know when stuff is happening, so they can come watch, and they can watch it on TV, and they have more, they know who the players are, and that's why people come to the field, because they know the players. But if they don't know who's playing and they don't know when or where, yeah, people aren't going to come and people aren't going to be interested.
Yeah, the media, so just imprisoned on the media.
Yeah, in the media, and exactly, like showing the games on TV and all this stuff, more interviews, more praise for how it's going and the players that are doing well, and I think that's really important.
How can we or you change that in the future to be like more accessible for a broader audience?
Oh, hard question. I don't know. I think it's just continue this, what's happening, and like I know me and a lot of Icelandic players as well, when we go to Iceland, we try and like go to our old clubs and like see the girls and inspire them in that way, so that they can see their role models even more, because we don't play in Iceland, so they don't see us as much, and the same with just like, yeah, being open to wanting to meet kids and, yeah, meet people and do media stuff. I think that's important.
What would you pass on to younger girls and younger boys to follow the dreams and to maybe become a professional football player as well?
I would say dream big, and then make small goals on the way to get there, and just know that not everyone has the same journey, not everyone has the same skills, so you can make your own road. You don't have to go the same way as somebody else, but you can make your own track on the way to your dream.
Regarding to the European Championship in the UK, how do you feel about that?
I'm really excited. I think it's going to be cool, and I think I hope a lot of people will come, and I think that it will be a good environment to be in for the fans and for the teams and everything. So I'm really excited, and I think we have a really nice team now with in Iceland. So I know we're going to have a really good time in our camp at least.
Yeah, the hype is getting bigger, like after seeing more than 90,000 people in Barcelona. So what do you think has to happen that it doesn't change or get back?
I think one big thing is we play in really small stadiums at the Euros, and I think that's taking a bit of a step back, because now, like you said, there's been 90,000 people in Camp Nou and 20, 30, 40,000 people at the other Champions League games. So I think having us play in a stadium for 4,000 people is a bit of a setback already. So I hope that they will learn from this, and in the future this won't happen again.
What do you think, or what do you expect about the audience at the championships?
I don't know about everyone else, but I know that Icelandic people will have a good time and they will be loud and we will hear them, definitely.
So what is your personal goal or achievement for the event?
For the Euros? I think we as a team, we want to go in and our biggest goal is to go out from the group, because we didn't manage that last time. But our first goal is just to win a game, and then from there on we have a good chance of going through the group, and then we will see what happens.
Good luck, so we hope the best.
Thank you.
Thank you for the interview.
No problem, thank you. I'm Glódís Viggósdóttir, and I play for Bayern Munich and the Icelandic national team, and this is my road to Wembley.